I would like to thank the organizers for the possibility to give talk in this beautiful conference and in this interesting country. Initially, I intended to give talk on what I work now with Professor Kacarkov, but in Miami. But after that, I decided to give talk on completed work. And that's why my talk is not just algebraic geometry; it's differential geometry, much closer to differential geometry. And it concerns the Yamabe problem in subriemannian geometry, so especially some special kind of subriemannian geometry, it's a quaternionic contact geometry. So first I will recall what is a Yamabe problem in Riemannian geometry, and a little bit history. So in 1960, Yamabe ask the following question: if we have a Riemannian manifold, if it's possible to find a metric in the conformal class of metrics, so the question is the following: is there exists a metric in the conformal class such that the scalar curvature of the new manifold, Riemannian manifold with the new metric, is constant? So he claimed to have a solution of this problem, but in 1968, Trudinger found an error in his proof, and it became a conjecture, and it was finally proved in 1984 by the joint effort of several mathematicians. Uben, Trudinger, and Schoen. So they consider the difference case. For example, if the manifold is spherical, is not spherical. Here in the Riemannian case is important the dimensions. The proofs are different in the different dimensions, and so on. So my talk is, as I mentioned, is a quaternionic contact version of this problem. It's well known that many of the problems in Riemannian geometry has a non-trivial subriemannian versions, and of course the tools are different in subriemannian geometry.
What is the SG?
Here, yes. It is the scalar curvature. Yes, of the, yes. To recall what this or not? I think it's not necessary. Differential, okay. Do you need to give some notes about Riemannian geometry, this object standards, so, in Riemannian geometry? So first, maybe the next slide. So first I'll give some preliminaries about quaternionic contact geometry. What's quaternionic contact manifold? It's a smooth manifold that has dimension 4 times n plus 3, and has it is endowed with data of codimension 3 distribution H, which is equipped with an SPN SP1 structure. That means that we have a fixed conformal class of Riemannian metrics on the H. It's the horizontal space. And also two-sphere bundle that is locally generated by three almost complex structures that satisfies the quaternionic relations, and which are Hermitian compatible with the metric, Riemannian metric. And H appears as the kernel of one form with values in R3, and also we have the following compatibility conditions. So this, the Riemannian metric, and these are the fundamental two forms that's associated with the almost complex structures. And it's important to note that if we have a given contact form, eta and h, there existed most one triple of almost complex structures, and the metric j on the horizontal space that are compatible. So that means that we have these conditions. And so, sorry, these conditions here, compatible, emission compatible. And also, it's important to recall that if we rotate the contact form, we obtain the same quaternionic contact structure. So the QC structure is invariant under rotation. And if we have a given horizontal space and a metric G on it, there is at most one sphere bundle associated of associated contact forms. It so it's yes, we have at most one sphere bundle of associated contact forms with a corresponding sphere bundle Q of almost complex structures. So these are well-known facts about the quaternionic contact geometry. That's maybe here. So the quaternionic contact manifolds were introduced in geometry by the French mathematician Olivier Bicard. And they appear naturally as the conformal boundary. It's the abstract definition of the conformal boundary at infinity of the quaternionic hyperbolic space. They also appear in connection with the quaternionic contact Imabe problem that we will discuss now. And they are, as I mentioned in the beginning, that they are a special kind of subriemannian geometry. So one can think that the quaternionic contact manifolds are quaternionic version of the famous CR manifolds, Kohl-Schirriemann manifolds. They are a generalization of three-socket manifolds. That means that any three-socket manifold, which is one of the basic examples of a quaternionic contact manifold, carries a natural quaternionic structure. So the three-socket manifolds, one possible definition is the following. We have a four-time n plus three-dimensional Riemannian manifold, and we could consider the conic metric on the cone, on this cone. And if this Riemannian metric is hyperkeller, which equivalent to this, then we say this is a 30-second manifold. It's one possible definition. So and it carries a natural quaternionic contact structure. Also, the quaternionic Heisenberg group is a basic example of a quaternionic contact manifold. It's so what is the role of Rn in the Riemannian geometry? The same is the role of the quaternionic Heisenberg group in the QC geometry, the quaternionic contact geometry. So a natural question is I mentioned that it's a quaternionic version of the CR manifolds. It's natural to ask if possible to find a octonionic version. But the issue is that there are no examples. So we can develop the theory, but there are no available examples about the formal octonionic contact manifolds. So in the CR geometry, it's important to know that any hyper surface in CN carries a CR structure. So there are many examples. In the QC geometry, the examples are not so many, but there exist examples. This and others. But in octonic contact geometry, there are no available examples, and it makes no sense to consider them. But maybe in the future, there will be found some examples. So there is a natural connection that is associated with any quaternionic contact manifold. It is the so-called Bicard connection. It was invented by Olivier Bicard also in 2000. And it states the following. This is the result of Bicard, that if we have a QC manifold of dimension bigger than 7, so result excludes the minimal possible dimension, there exists a unique supplementary distribution V of the horizontal space in TM and a linear connection nabla. It's the Bicard connection, such that nabla preserves the decomposition H plus V. So if we differentiate the horizontal vector field, we obtain again horizontal vector field. If we differentiate the vertical vector field, we obtain again vertical vector field. And also the SPN SP1 structure on H. It is we have that it pieces the metric and the sections of the two-sphere bundle also. And the torsion on the horizontal space is given by this restriction. So we have the commutator of two horizontal vector fields. And the restriction on the vertical, it's a vertical vector. It's the torsion on restricted on H. So and if we have a vertical vector, we can define so endomorphism on H, which lies in the orthogonal complement of this direct sum of the Lie groups SPN, Lie algebra SPN SP1. So the connection on the vertical space is induced by the natural identification V of V with the subspace of the endomorphisms of H. So we have this condition. So this is the result of Picard, but it's the bigger dimension in the smallest possible dimension. There exists analogous result. It is obtained by Duchman. But I will call back later to this. So here is important that the vertical space is generated by the so-called rib vector fields. So this is the rib vector fields, and they are determined by these conditions. So in dimension 7, as I mentioned, it's important to note that these conditions not always are satisfied. But if we suppose additionally that these conditions are satisfied, then the Duchman result says that there exists an analog of the Picard connection in this smallest possible dimension, seven dimension. So, and using the triple of three vector fields, we can extend the remaining metric which is given on the horizontal space to remaining metric on the entire tangent bundle by requiring span the three vector fields, the span space of three vector fields, which is of course V, to be orthogonal to H. So this is explicitly the metric, remaining metric on the entire tangent bundle. So maybe another. Okay. Yes. Since we use many indices, it's important to make the following convention. Convention about the indices. So we use A, B, C, and so on for the indices in this set. Also, the Greek letters alpha, beta, gamma, and so on in this set. Alpha, tilde, beta, tilde, and so on shall mean indices in this set. And to, as you usually use the Einstein convention for the sums. And so we also introduced the following notation for the SPN SP1 frame and the rib vector fields. We introduced the following unified notation. And the co-frame of this frame we shall denote by these letters. So here I recall some standard objects that they appear in remaining geometry. They have the same analogs in quaternary contact geometry, more generally in sub-remaining geometry. So the torsion tensor is given by this. The torsion tensor of type 1-3 is given via the metric, is given by this. The torsion endomorphism on H is given by this if we fix some vertical vector. So we can decompose this endomorphism into its symmetric part and skew symmetric part. So this here shall denote the symmetric part and this the skew symmetric part. And also we have the symmetric trace-free endomorphism on H, which is given by this. So the representation of the skew symmetric part, there appears also a representation of the skew symmetric part where mu is traceless symmetric 1-1 tensor on H, which commutes with the almost complex structures. It's matter. Also, the curvature is defined in this usual way. The QC Ricci tensor, it's the horizontal trace of the curvature. So here, Xi alpha and Xi alpha is orthonormal frame of the horizontal part of the tangent bundle. And H and X and Y are some horizontal vectors. So here appears some special type of tensor. These are the so-called QC rich type tensors. They are defined by these traces. And also the QC scalar curvature is given by the horizontal trace of the QC rich tensor. It's in the remaining geometry. Next. Here I will explain in detail some more about the quaternionic Heisenberg group. As I said, this group is given by x powered by n times the imaginary part of H. Here H is the field of the quaternions. And the multiplication law is given by this equality. So if you use real coordinates, there appears the standard left invariant QC contact forms. They are given by this. And their dual left invariant real vector fields are given by these equalities. The left invariant horizontal one forms and their dual vectors are given by this here. And of course, we have a decomposition of the tangent bundle into its horizontal part and vertical part. And also on the Heisenberg group, the left invariant flat connection is just the Bicard connection. So the Heisenberg here is the flat example. So as I mentioned in the beginning, it's the same row of Rn in the Riemannian geometry. So, next. So, are there some questions to the moment? Some question about this. Okay. So, what's the conformal change of the QC structure? So, it's everybody knows this. If we have a smooth function, we can consider this. We can consider. Maybe something happens. So maybe I will continue here.
Right, I guess so.
So if we have what is maybe here, maybe I wait. So. Do you need some help?
No.
Help. Thank okay. Thank you very much. So, I'm ready to continue. Okay. So, what is the conformal change of the QC structure? If you have a smooth function, then it's given by this usual way. And here, it's a result of my PhD advisor in Sofia and his collaborator. So the QC conformal curvature tensor is given by this complicated equality. It's the analog of the Weyl tensor in Riemannian geometry, and it's the abstraction of manifold. As we know, the Weyl tensor is just the abstraction, the abstraction for a manifold to be conformal to the plane or the Rn. So in this case, this is the analog, quaternionic contact analog of the Weyl tensor, and also the Chern-Moser tensor in CR geometry. In CR geometry appears this tensor, but it's much more complicated due to the almost complex structure that appears here. And it is given by this. So it's identically equal to zero if and only if it's, I will show later, if and only if the quaternionic contact manifold is equivalent in some sense to the quaternionic contact Heisenberg group or the Terisakian sphere, because the Terisakian sphere with its natural quaternionic contact structure are homothetic to the Heisenberg group. They are equivalent in some sense. So, and this is the abstraction for to QC manifold to be equivalent, to be flat in some sense. So, it is the quaternionic contact Yamabe problem. For a compact QC manifold, if there exists a metric in the conformal class of metrics on the Quasi-Zotov space, which has a constant QC square curvature. It is the problem. And this problem is equivalent to solvability of this equation. So here, Nabu F is the Laplacian, the sub-Laplacian, which is as usually analog of the Laplace Beltrami Laplacian in the Riemannian geometry. And it is given by the horizontal trace of the Hessian, the horizontal Hessian. And S and S bar are the QC square curvature associated with the old manifold and the new manifold. And here to study some constant, specific constant. And Q is a homogeneous dimension of the manifold. So the QC Yamabe equation 1 is just the Euler-Lagrange equation of the QC Yamabe functional, which is defined by this. So of course here are some functions, for example, in some objects, Nabu F is the subgradient of F. And the volume eta are, and volume eta bar are natural volume form associated with the almost complex structures and the metric on the manifold. So, maybe the next. So the QC Yamabe constant is given as the infimum. So it is the definition of the it is given as the infimum of the Yamabe functional over the space of the contact forms. It's equivalent to this. So if we fix the initial contact form, we can move the functions of the conformal change. It's equivalent to this. So in the QC Yamabe constant on the sphere, it's important to know the QC Yamabe constant on the sphere is computed in 2010, and it has this complicated expression. QC Yamabe constant, and it's the basic main result of Wang, that the QC Yamabe constant of compact quaternionic contact manifold is always less or equal to this constant. This. And if the constant is strictly less than this, then the result is that the QC Yamabe problem has a solution. So, and our problem reduces to this when is possible the Yamabe constant on the compact quaternionic contact manifold to be strictly less than this number. So, and here is our main result that if we suppose that M is a compact QC manifold of any dimension, which is possible, there are no dimensional restrictions. And if M is not locally QC equivalent to the standard three-second structure on the sphere, then we have that the Yamabe constant is strictly less than the constant on the sphere. And thus, the conclusion is that the QC Yamabe problem can be solved on the quaternionic contact manifold. And as I mentioned here, there are no dimensional restrictions in the cases because it's due to the big dimension, because the lowest possible dimension is too big, it's a 7, because in the CR geometry, the lowest possible dimension is 3, and it's there, the proof for 3-dimensional is different from the bigger dimensions. So, and this. But here, there are no dimensional restrictions. So, and so it's a result of Kunkel. He began to explore this question, but this but he didn't complete this work, and it's his result that on a QC manifold with a given Picard connection on and decomposition associated with this Picard connection, if we choose the a point on M and this decomposition of the tangent vector, then we can define gamma xy to be the curve with that satisfies these conditions. It's unique. And so the result is that there exists a neighborhood of the tangent space near the point at the tangent space at the point Q, and the neighborhood of near Q on M, such that this function, defined by this wall, is diffeomorphism, and it satisfies parabolic scaling equation. This means that we have this. Result supplies to introduce the so-called quaternionic contact normal coordinates, and these are analogs of so anybody knows that in the remain geometry, there appears the so-called normal coordinates, and they serve for simplification of the computation, because if we have something that we must compute, and this thing is invariant under the coordinates, it's very useful to introduce normal coordinates in this point, and this leads to simplification of the computations. In this So due to this result, we can introduce some normal coordinates associated with the fixed quaternionic contact manifold, and so if we have orthonormal frame of the tangent bundle, so the idea is that if this our quaternionic contact manifold and we fix some point, then at this point we can choose some orthonormal frame R E X alpha, and we can move this frame along the geodesics, and in this manner we obtain a local orthonormal frame in a neighborhood of P, and due to this orthonormal frame we can define the normal coordinates. So we have a map in this wall that's given by this wall, and this defines these are the so-called Kunkel's parabolic normal coordinates, and they simplify a lot the computation, because here the computations are too long and too complicated. So here the generator of parabolic dilations on the quaternionic Heisenberg group is given by this. It is the parabolic dilations. The generator is just this vector, this vector field. And here is important to he introduced some notion about the homogeneity of the tensors. So if we have a tensor field on the Heisenberg group, we say that this tensor field is homogeneous of order m if the Lie derivative with respect to this vector field satisfy this of this tensor satisfy this equality. So also for any tensor field phi, the symbol fm will denote the part of the tensor which is homogeneous of order m. And this is the main result of Kunkel, that if we have a QC manifold and we fix the point, then there exists a homogeneous polynomial U in QC parabolic normal coordinates, such that for the new QC manifold with this conformal change, the following object vanishes at the point Q. Here is the scalar curvature, the torsion tensor, the skew symmetric part of the, and so on. This all in this fixed point are zero. And this simplifies a lot of the computations. So it's useful to introduce the notion of weight of a tensor. Here we introduce the so this notation OA will denote one if A is in this set, and OA will denote two if A is in this set. So, and if we suppose that F is a homogeneous polynomial in the X alpha and TI, these are the quaternionic contact parabolic normal coordinates, whose coefficients are polynomial expressions in the curvature, the torsion, and the covariant derivatives of Q, we define the weight of this homogeneous polynomial by this. So it's a recursive definition. So the torsion, the weight of the torsion is given by this. Here the comma denotes the covariant derivative. So I finished. So and the weight of the curvature is given by this. The weight of the multiplication of two polynomials is equal to the sum of the weight of the polynomials. And this also we have. So next, maybe I will skip. These are some technical things. So we have this result that the metric, the almost complex structure in the volume form are of weight zero. The torsion is of weight one. These objects are of weight two, and so on. And we shall use the following result of Kunkel, that if we have a QC manifold, then at the center Q of the normalization that we have, the only invariant scalar quantities of weight no more than 4 are just the constant and the squared norm of the QC conformal tensor. So this is the abstraction for, as I mentioned, for the manifold to be QC equivalent to the sphere. So, and if we suppose, so it's a technical part, I will skip it because I have no time. So here it's important that we have some function that are extremals of the QC Amabe functional. And we introduce here some neighborhoods and also the test functions. We introduce some specifically the test function which will help us to explore the infimum of the QC Amabe functional, but it's technical. And so it's one of our basic results that the QC Amabe functional over the test function that were defined on the previous slide has the next asymptotic expression. So we have this asymptotic expression. Here A and B are some independent of the QC structure dimensional constants. And the next step is to compute explicitly these constants. So and due to long computations, we obtain that the QC Amabe if for a quaternionic contact manifold with a fixed QC contact form normalized at a fixed point Q. Then we have that the QCM Abbe functional over the set of the test functions has this asymptotic expression. And it's important that if we suppose that here is the basic point, that if we suppose that the quaternionic manifold is not spherical, that means that we always can find the point where this tensor is not zero. And so if we make our normalization at this point, that we consider this functional in the neighborhood of this point, we have that this is not zero. This is the Yamabe constant on the sphere, and Cn is some positive constant. And if we let epsilon to go to zero, we obtain the infimum of this functional over the set of this test functions is strictly less than lambda. It's important. Here the constants are very important, and also the appearing of the powers of this small epsilon. Here we have epsilon on power 4, here is on power 5. And of course this is the end of my talk, because this proof is our main result for us from this asymptotic expression. So thank you very much.
Well, thanks again.
Thank you very much.